moment we are in London. We have 4 students and 3 teachers, and we've got a few props and some acting. We're going to read book 10 of the Odyssey, in which Odysseus meets Circe. We'll be reading in English, and we're really excited to be part of Odysseus 24. Woo!
Disembarked, collecting water. Your men straight away had a quick meal by the ships. But as soon as they had something to eat and drink, Odysseus took a messenger and one of his comrades to accompany him and set out for the palace of Aeolus, whom they found at dinner with his wife and family. They went in and sat down on the threshold by the doorposts.
Odysseus, how do you come to be here? What evil power has dealt with this blood? We did our best to help you on your way home to the hill or any port you might choose.
And a trustworthy crew and a fatal sleep in my downfall. Put things right for me, my friends, you easily could.
Get off this island instantly. The world holds no one more damnable than you, and it's not right for me to entertain an equipped man detested by the blessed gods. Your return on this shows they detest you. Get out.
They dismissed me from the palace, causing me deep distress. We left the island and resumed our journey in a state of gloom, and the heart was taken out of my men by wearisome rowing, but it was our own stupidity that had deprived us of the wind.
For 6 days and 6 nights they sailed on, and on the 7th we came to Terpylos, Lamus' stronghold in the Lystragonian land. Here they found an excellent harbour, closed in on all sides by an unbroken ring of precipitous cliffs, with 2 jutting headlands facing each other at the mouth so as to leave only a narrow channel in between. The captains of his squadron all steered their curved craft straight to the harbour, but Odysseus did not follow them. Instead, he brought his black ship to rest outside the harbour and made her fast with a cable to the rock at the end of the point. He then climbed the headland to get a view from the top. But no cultivated fields or herds of cattle were visible. All they saw was a wisp of smoke rising up from the countryside. So he sent a party inland to find out what sort of people the inhabitants were. 2 of my men, together with a messenger.
They found a well-worn track used by wagons bringing timber down from the high mountains to the town. Presently, they came across a strong girl drawing water outside the town, the daughter of Antiphates, the Lystragonian chief. When they went up and asked her who the ruler of the country was and what his people were called, she pointed at once to the high roof of her father's dwelling. When they entered his palace, they were confronted by Antiphates' wife, a woman of mountainous proportions. The sight of her appalled them. She called her husband, the famous Antiphates, from one of the assembly places, who promptly made his murderous intentions clear, pouncing on one of his men to lead them for supper. The other two sprang back and fled and managed to make their way back to the ships.
Meanwhile, Antiphates raised a hue and a cry throughout the town, which brought countless number of powerful Lystragonians running up from every side, more like giants than men. Standing at the top of the cliffs, they began pelting his flotilla with lumps of rock, such as ordinary man could barely lift. And the din that now rose from the ships, where the groans of dying men could be heard above the splintering of timbers, was appalling. They carried them off like fishes upon a spear to make their loathsome meal.
But while this massacre was still going on in the deep harbour, I drew my sword from my hip, slashed the hawser of my blue-prowed vessel, and shouted to the crew to bend their oars if they wished to save their lives. With the fear of death upon them, they struck the water like one man, and to our relief and joy, we shot out to sea and left those frowning cliffs behind. My ship was safe, but that was the end of all the rest.
They travelled on with heavy hearts, grieving for the loss of their dear friends, though rejoicing at their own escape. In due course, they came to the island of Aea, the home of beautiful Circe, a formidable goddess with a mortal woman's voice. They brought their ship into the shelter of the harbour without making a sound. And when they had disembarked, they lay on the beach for 2 days and nights, utterly exhausted and eating out their hearts with grief.
On the third day, I took my spear and sword and left the ship and struck inland. I climbed a rocky height, and upon reaching the top, I was able to see smoke rising from the distant place where Circe's house lay in the clearing. That glimpse I had of reddish smoke left me in two minds whether or not to press forward and to reconnoitre. After some thought, I decided the better course would be to return first to my ship on the beach and give my men a meal and send out an exploring party. And then some god was moved to pity by my forlorn condition. For when I had almost reached the ship, he sent a great antlered stag right across my path. And as he came up, I struck him on the spine halfway down his back. My bronze spear went right through him, and with a bellow, he fell to the dust.
When he reached the ship, he threw the stag down in front of it, and going up to each man in turn, pardoned them with a cheerful word.
My friends, we may be miserable, but we are not going down to the house of Hades yet. Not till our time has come. Get up, and while there's food and drink on board, let us have something to eat instead of dying here of starvation.
This was advice they took readily enough. They at once flung off their rugs, and there on the desolate seashore, they gazed open-mouthed at the stag. He really was a monster. When they had feasted their eyes on their sight, they washed their hands and prepared a glorious meal. When the sun set and darkness fell, they lay down to sleep on the seashore. As soon as dawn appeared, fresh and rosy-fingered, Odysseus gathered his men around and addressed them.
Comrades in suffering, friends, listen to me. We are utterly lost. We do not know where east or west is, where the light-giving sun rises, or where he sets. So the sooner we decide on a sensible plan, the better, if one can still be found, which I doubt. But when I climbed the crag, I found that this is an island, and low-lying, all around it in a ring of sea stretched away to the horizon. What I did see, right in the middle, through dense oak scrub and forest, was a wisp of smoke.
When they heard his report, they broke down completely. They could not help remembering what Antiphates the Lystragonian had done, and the unbridled savagery of the man-eating Cyclops. In the end, he divided his well-armed crew into two parties, with a leader for each. Of one party, Odysseus himself took charge. The other he gave to noble Eurylochus. Then we shook lots in a bronze helmet, and out jumped the lot of the great-hearted Eurylochus. So he went off with his 22 men, a tearful company, leaving us, who stayed behind, weeping too.
He came upon Circe's house, built of polished stone, howling about the banks where mountain wolves and lions Circe had bewitched with her magic drugs. They did not attack my men, rose on their hind legs to fawn on them, with much hugging of their long tails.
Terrified of the sight of the beasts, they stood in the palace porch of the goddess with the lovely tresses. They could hear Circe within singing her beautiful voice as she went to and fro at her great everlasting loom, on which she was weaving one of those delicate and graceful, dazzling fabrics that goddesses make. Polites, an authoritative man, and the one in the party who I liked and trusted the most, now took the lead.
"Friend, there is someone in the castle working at the whole place echoes to the lovely voice. It's either a goddess or a woman. Let us call her immediately."
So they called, and Circe came out at once, opened the polished doors, and invited them to enter. In their innocence, the whole party followed her in. But Eurylochus suspected a trap and stayed outside. Circe ushered the rest into her hall, gave them seats and chairs to sit on, and then prepared them a mixture of cheese, barley meal, and yellow honey flavoured with Pramnian wine. But into this dish she produced a noxious drug to make them lose all memory of their native land. And when they had emptied the bowls which she handed them, she drove them with blows of a stick into the pigsties. Now they had pigs' heads and bristles, and they grunted like pigs, but their minds were as human as they had been before. So weeping, they repented in their styes. Then Circe flung them some forest nuts and acorns and cornel berries, the usual food of pigs that wallow in the mud.
Meanwhile, Eurylochus came back to the ship to report the catastrophe his party had met with. He was in such anguish that he could not utter a single word. His eyes were filled with tears, and he felt on the verge of breaking down. Exasperated, we all bombarded him with questions, till at length he came out with his story of his comrade's fate.
"We went as you ordered through your words, noble Odysseus. We came to a well-built house of polished stone. Someone inside was singing in a clear voice, and she went to and fro with act of great breath, either a goddess or a woman. My men called out as she came up, immediately opened the polished doors, and invited us to enter. In their innocence, the whole party followed her in. I suspected the trap and stayed outside. And now the whole party has been wiped out. Not a single man reappeared, though I sat there a long time to watch it."
"Take me now, please."
"Favourite of Zeus, leave me behind. Don't force me to go with you there. You will never come back yourself, and you won't rescue a single man of your crew. I am certain of it. Let us get away quickly with those that are left here. We might still escape the evil day."
"Very well, Eurylochus. Stay where you are, eat and drink by the black ship's hold, but I shall go. I have absolutely no choice."
Odysseus struck inland, threading his way through the enchanted glades, and was nearing the sorceress's palace when he met Hermes, god of the golden wand. He took his hand and greeted him.
"Where are you off to now, my poor fellow? Wandering alone through the world's an unknown country. With your friends in Circe's house, penned like pigs in their crowded styes. Have you come here to freedom? I think you're more likely to stay with them yourself and never see your home. However, I will save you and deliver you from your trouble. Here is a drug, real virtue. You must take with you into Circe's palace. It will make you immune from evil. She'll begin preparing your mixture into which you'll put her drug. But even with its help, she'll be unable to enchant you, for this antidote that I'm going to give you will be able to When Circe strikes you with her long stick, you must draw your sword from your side and rush at her as though you need to kill her. She will shriek from you in terror and invite you to her bed. You must not refuse the goddess's favours if you want her to free your men and look after you. Make her swear a solemn oath by the blessed gods not to try any more of her tricks on you. Or when she has stripped you naked, she may rob you of your courage and manhood."
Then Hermes handed him a herb he had plucked from the ground and showed him what it was like. It had a black root and a milk-white flower. The gods call it moly, and it is a dangerous plant for mortal men to dig up. But the gods, after all, can do anything.
Odysseus followed her indoors, and she offered him a beautiful silver-studded chair with a stool for his feet. She prepared a brew in a golden bowl for him to drink, and with evil in her heart, dropped in the drug. She gave him the bowl, and he drained it, but without suffering any magic effects. She struck him with her stick and shouted,
"Off to the pigsty with you, and lie down with your friends."
Whereupon Odysseus snatched his keen sword from his hip and rushed at Circe as though he meant to kill her. But with a shriek, She slipped below his blade, clasped his knees, and burst into tears.
Who are you, and where do you come from? Where is your native town? Who are your parents? I am amazed to see that you take my drug and suffer no magic change. For never before have I known a man who could resist that drug once he had taken it and swallowed it down. You must have a heart in your breast that is proof against all enchantment. I am sure that you are Odysseus, that resourceful man, the man whom the giant killer, with the golden wand, always told me to expect here on his way back from Troy in his swift black ship. But now you put up your sword and come with me to my bed, so that in making love, we may learn to trust one another.
Circe, how can you order me to be gentle with you? You who have turned my friends into pigs here in your house, and now that you have me too in your clutches, inviting me to your bed, rob me of my courage and my manhood. Nothing, goddess, would induce me to come to your bed unless you can bring yourself to swear a solemn oath that you have no other mysteries in store.
Odysseus, why are you sitting like this, though you were dumb, and feeding on your own thoughts instead of helping me to meet his wife? Do you suspect another trap? You need have no fears. I have given you a solemn oath to do you no harm.
So as he could any honourable man bear to taste food and drink before he freed his men and seen them face to face? If you are sincere in asking me to eat and drink, give them their liberty and let me set my eyes on my lord.
Favourite of Zeus, son of Laertes, Odysseus of the mighty devices, go now down to your ship by the seashore, drag her straight onto dry land, store your possessions and all the ship's tackle in the cave, and then come back to yourself with the rest of your loyal company.
Odysseus was convinced. He went to the ship and the seashore, found his good companions by the ship, lamenting pitifully, with the tears streaming down their cheeks. But as soon as they caught sight of him, they were all round him in a weeping throng. It was like the scene at a farm when cows in a drove come home full fed from the pastures to the yard and are welcomed by all their frisking calves, who burst out from the pens to gambol round the mothers, lowing excitedly.
We are
starting
to see that as we continue to step
onto
our own island of Ithaca. But tell us how our comrades met their end.
Our first business is to drag up the ship onto dry land, stow our possessions and tackle in the cave. Then you must get ready and all come with me to see your friends eating and drinking in Circe's enchanted palace, where they have enough to last them for.
Only Eurylochus was against them and did his best to keep the whole company back.
Where are we poor wretches off to now? Why are you looking for trouble going to Circe's palace, where she will turn you all into pigs or wolves or lions, and force you to keep watch over that great house of hers? We have had all this before with the Cyclops. When our friends found their way into this fold with this foolhardy Odysseus, it was this man's reckless folly that cost them their lives.
When Eurylochus said that, he considered drawing the long sword from his sturdy side and lopping